Welcome to Connie Martinson Talks Books. My guest has written a book called Emotional Memoirs and Short Stories. Each one is as if you were visiting a jeweler and you're looking at one beautiful piece after another. My guest is Lonnie Hall Albert, and welcome, Lonnie.
Thank you so much, Connie.
Well, it's true. Each of these short stories and pieces are as if you are looking in a jeweler's box with the glass, and you're seeing one different one after another, but each is like a different diamond.
They certainly are different, that's for sure.
Yeah.
And they are kind of like diamonds. Yeah. To me, they are.
Well, they are. Beginning with the first one with Jackie.
Yeah.
Jackie is every older, sort of older woman that a teenage kid can not have a crush on, but just think she is the best.
Yes, yes.
Yeah.
She was the epitome of modern.
Yeah.
And hip. And a very important aspect of my relationship with her was music.
Yeah.
Because she had a tremendous jazz collection. And so I would go over there when I would babysit for her son, and I would listen to jazz. I would listen to all the yeah. albums that she had.
And they lived next door to your parents' yeah. apartment, and I'm sure the parents were not that thrilled about their
no.
teenage girl being influenced by a woman 21.
Right, absolutely.
And her husband has had it. She's playing around. And he goes off to New York, and she's suddenly the single woman that this teenager is watching.
Yes, she was the role model.
Yeah.
But she also played an important part for me, because the house that I lived in, the apartment that I lived
yeah.
in with my parents, it was very volatile. And it was hard for me to breathe there at times.
Yeah.
And so going to Jackie's was going to the demilitarized
yeah.
zone. You know,
yeah.
I had some place to go,
yeah.
and I used it, and she was my friend. I felt that she was my friend.
Yeah, and she's got different guys coming in and out.
After she left her husband,
yeah.
yes.
Yeah, but the story has a denouement. When you're in New York, you're singing, and you look her up, and she's gone back to the husband, and she doesn't want you to remember anything.
No, she doesn't want to remember
yeah.
anything.
Yeah.
It's too painful. It was
yeah.
too painful.
And also, she's cut it out.
Yes.
Yeah.
She says she's cut it out.
Yeah.
But then,
yeah.
when I called her after I wrote the story and I read it to her, she said, she's never forgotten the love affair that
yeah.
she had, that I was witness to.
Yeah.
And
how did that influence your life?
Well, I think that it influenced my life in a lot of ways, but I yeah. think that it really seared in never to use drugs.
Yeah.
And I mean, you know, to find someone laying in a bed dead.
Yeah.
A beautiful 22-year-old man.
Yeah.
Because of heroin, that was a big wake-up call.
Ooh,
you know, just
yeah.
in case I was thinking about it,
yeah.
I stopped thinking about it quickly.
Lots of analysts in your life.
Yeah. Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
They're not portrayed as that positive. I mean, beginning with Dr.
Portuguese.
Yeah, Portuguese. But what was interesting, how you were able to assimilate what his life must be like.
Yeah, yeah. Well, I wanted to write a story about bad therapy.
Yeah.
And that's what I want. That was my. I didn't really set out to write it like that, because all the dreams in that story, even though it's fictional, all the dreams are mine.
Yeah.
And I woke up one morning with the first dream, and I wrote it down, and I just kept writing. And
yeah.
then I made it like I was speaking, I was telling this dream to this analyst.
Yeah.
And right from there, that's when I started moving with the story.
Yeah.
And
but the countertransference
yeah.
that goes on, that you could make him have his own problems.
Big problems. Far bigger than the
yeah.
girls. Far bigger than the main character's
yeah.
problems.
And I do think that's not too far from the truth for a lot of them.
I think so, too.
Yeah.
I think so, too. And the transference is a really big issue. Yeah. When you give yourself to somebody else without really knowing the backstory of that person,
yeah,
you're just going on pure faith and trust, when you might be giving your faith and trust to someone that doesn't deserve it.
You've been a singer, and it was almost falling in the back door. As you became a singer, singing was going to be your pleasure at home. And then somebody heard you, and there you were.
It's amazing, that story, yeah. I mean, it just kind of unfolded.
In Chicago.
In Chicago. It just unfolded, and I was placed in a position at the right time.
Yeah.
And in the right place, and it just started moving on its own and taking me with it, and I was a willing subject.
Yeah. But what about with the professor? That story of the throat sort of tightening up and not being able to give the heart out that you had been.
Yeah. That was... that really didn't happen to me. That was also fictional. But
yeah,
the character of the professor was a trumpet teacher, actually, that Herb had, my husband. And we loved him. He was a dear, dear friend of ours. Yeah. And so I wanted to write about him. And so I made it that that a singer was, yeah, having problems. And it gave me the opportunity to really express my feelings and how deeply I feel about music and singing.
Yeah. Yeah. Tell me, how do you feel?
About music and singing?
Yeah.
Well, I feel that singing has really saved my soul. I think I would have been a very different person had I not had a vehicle to express myself.
Yeah.
And it wasn't so much, I hear people say when they sing or they, yeah, like to sing, they're so happy when they sing. I was never happy singing. I had to sing.
Yeah.
It was. It wasn't just something that I wanted to do. I needed to sing. I needed a vehicle to express myself,
mm-hmm,
and that was my vehicle. And music has always touched me and made things come alive.
Yeah.
You know, it has always done that to me. I mean, I could look at you, for example, and if you put music on, suddenly you'll change in my eyes, you,
yeah,
know, because the music enhances it.
Yeah.
And so music and singing have been integral
parts. Did you
parts.
Study voice?
No, I didn't.
No.
I did not. No.
Yeah. So it was all natural breathing.
It was the love of the music I was hearing, and I just, that was my natural, that was natural for me to do,
yeah,
to jump up and start singing.
Yeah.
You know, but not for people. I didn't like to sing in front of people. That wasn't something I was comfortable with. I liked to sing alone. And yeah, when I joined Sergio Mendes and Brazil 66, the group that I sang with for 5 years, I loved to do sing in the recording studio.
Mm-hmm.
That worked for me.
Yeah.
But singing in front of people took a really long time for me to feel comfortable with.
Yeah. What about acting?
No, I never act.
Never act. But no. Singing is acting.
Singing is acting with the lyrics to the song.
Yeah.
And that's what I really hook onto when I sing. I express the lyric in the song. And it's...
What music did you play while you were writing?
Oh, no, you know, when I write, and it's very much like when I sing.
Yeah.
It's spontaneous, and the writing is like music to me.
Mm-hmm.
The writing has rhythm to it. It has a sound to it.
Uh-huh.
It has a tempo and a harmony. It has and that's what I'm very aware of when I'm writing. I'm aware of the rhythm of everything.
I'm aware of it reading it, because I said to you that the story that's called The Cleaning Woman has such good, you know, sort of conflict there, and it's about a woman who's going to commit suicide, and the cleaning woman comes in, and it's almost like your turn to dance, mine to sing, that the cleaning woman finally gets her to, I'll call your brother, but it turns out the cleaning woman had escaped the Holocaust.
Yeah, to me that story is about the kindness of strangers.
Yeah.
I mean, the cleaning lady was really patient and understood what was happening immediately, mainly because of her own troubled past.
Right.
Because she recognized trouble when she saw it, and she saw it in this woman. And she wanted to help her, and she knew that if she'd leave the office that she was in, this woman would jump out the window.
Yeah. What was the sort of the catalyst for that story?
You know, I don't know. I think it was just probably an idea that I had about a woman sitting on her office floor, drinking, getting drunk, wanting to get up the courage to jump out the window.
And she has written her
suicide note.
Yeah.
And she's just waiting to get the courage to do it.
Yeah.
And she didn't realize that the cleaning lady was going to be walking through the halls in the evening.
Yeah.
And so the story goes.
Yeah.
To me, the stories are very much, when I'm writing them, they're very much like jazz. They're taking me on a journey, and I'm going with them.
Because you said to me the story that I liked, and I thought it was a real, was the one about what her name is, her husband's Brian, and she meets Angie, and she's had a fight with her husband, and she's gone out on the road. Well, because this girl comes into the car, and I thought she was going to be malevolent. And it turns out she isn't really, in the way the story goes. But the husband, because she's gone, calls the police, and they say, sorry, fella, she's going to be gone 24 hours.
24 hours,
yeah. Yeah.
That's right. Yeah, I feel like Angie was kind of an angel to Eve, the main character in this book. To me, that story is about postpartum depression. Because this woman, Eve, lost her child.
Yeah.
And, you know, and so here, this was her working it out. And this was her way of doing it. And that life caught up with her.
Yeah.
I mean, there's a bear attack in this story.
A
horrible bear attack.
Yeah.
And she has to take care of and nurse this girl that just had her.
And they don't know each other's last names or phone numbers.
No, and she disappears.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. And then the end, there's that magical thing that happened with the deer.
Yeah.
And you don't really know. There's ambiguity there. You don't really know, did she hit her head and she dreamt this, or what happened here? I like that ambiguity.
Yeah.
I like that you don't really know.
You know, I would love to have you read just a little bit so that they get a feeling of the type of writing and how it affected me. Page 144, I believe it was.
Uh-huh. Okay. This is the emotional memoir page that are before all the short stories. So this is the kind of the bridge to all the stories, and this is nonfiction. I was 20 when I left Chicago. I had an opportunity to leave, and I took it. The hardest part was leaving my brother behind. Perhaps I thought I would just be a short break away from home, but when I left Chicago, I would never leave there. I would never live there again. Each time I came back to visit, the face of the neighborhood had changed. They tore down the Terminal Theater. I used to walk by it and tip my head way back just to see the statue of the Roaring Lion perched on the very top. 75 cents would place me in its magical darkness all day long. I'd stay to see double features over and over again, eat popcorn and candy and run up and down the lavish staircase that led to the balcony and let the big screen swallow